Warning, Weird West Radio contains adult language and discussions. If you're easily offended, do not continue to listen. Everybody, we are back here on Weird West Radio, the Hell on Wheels edition on Rain Man Digital. You can find all of our previous and I guess current shows, past shows, future shows, all on rainmanwashere.com/Weird West Radio. And if you want the Hell on Wheels edition, that's Weird West Radio slash Hell on Wheels. We missed last week's review, which kind of disappointing that we missed it. I was trying to stay as consistent as possible, Clint.
We do try.
But I was out of town in Los Angeles, actually promoting one of our other shows on this network, and there was just no way, man. I mean, I even missed the screening to the Homesman, I believe it's called, Tommy Lee Jones' new Western.
Oh, wow.
And I was so upset, man, because I was so pumped about seeing that, and it was actually on Thursday, the day before we leave, before I left out of town, and I'm looking, I'm like, okay, it's at 10 a.m., the screening, I can do this, and there's no way. We had a live show that night, plus we had to leave town that night, then get promotion stuff done, so I was highly disappointed.
We are the Hell on Wheels of Rain Man Digital.
Yeah. You sent me that message, and I started laughing when you were like, yeah, it's okay. Like, I could pretty much hear how you said it. You're like, yeah, mm-hmm. So basically, your supernatural show is The Walking Dead of Rain Man Digital, and you treat us like shit.
Yeah, I was telling my wife that. I go, God, I really hope he takes this as a joke.
Oh, no, I laughed really loud, dude. But at the same time, it made me feel guilty. I'm like, God damn it. I'm like, I hate that shit. Like, I hate that AMC treats, you know, Hell on Wheels like the redheaded stepchild.
And here we are.
And yeah, so no more, Clint. I'm dedicated. So, all right. So, AMC, let's get into this, man. AMC renews Hell on Wheels for fifth and final season. Now, we did jump into this, but the show never came out. So, let me go back. So, AMC renews Hell on Wheels for fifth and final season. The final 14 episodes will be split into summer runs in 2015 and 2016. So, basically, we're getting two more seasons is how I look at it. I don't know why they don't just say, hey guys, we're doing two more seasons. We ordered 7 episodes per season. Boom. That way people can bitch. You know, when you say, hey, one final season and we're splitting it up a year apart.
Well, it's just like this last thing that they did of what, a month of October and we only have 3 episodes left.
Yeah, I mean they did this with Breaking Bad and they did this with Walking Dead with the seasons, but it's different because they only space Breaking Bad up by like 6 seasons. This is a whole fucking year, a whole year that they're gonna do this, and you know a lot, dude. It's not me. The internet is filled with hate right now about this, about the news. They're like, oh yay, we got a final season. Oh wait a second, final season, and it's gonna be split up in 2 different. Basically 2 different years. And bottom line is this is straight up a strategic business move. How can we benefit from basically 2 seasons worth of making money off of marketing and advertisement on one cost? Basically, they're going to be, AMC is going to be, it's basically 2-for-1, Clint. You know what I mean? Yeah, like you're paying for the production of 1 full season, but you're going to get 2 seasons worth of advertisement and marketing dollars, if that makes sense.
Well, and like you've even said, they've got the set there, they've got everything ready, so if they want to do that, and make this split season instead of making a separate season. Yeah. I mean, at least they got the stuff there and they're ready to go and they can finish it the way they want to finish it.
It's just so disappointing, though. And I'm going to go ahead and speak on behalf of some of the Hell on Wheels fans out there and the stuff that I've read on Reddit and Facebook. It's just, come on. I mean, it barely feels like the season got going. I mean, there was 2 years of kind of confusion and storytelling when they were trying to work out who's going to run the show the following year. And then all of a sudden we get John Worth and the story starts to evolve finally and you start getting some character development that wasn't really there. I mean, Bohan is really coming out of his shell. And then, hey guys, one more season. And we're going to split it up into 7 episodes. You know, like, it is a little... I mean, I don't want to be ungrateful. I'm happy that we're getting a final season, but it's almost like an F you to the fans. Like, hey, guys, we're going to go ahead and end this show like we wanted to 3 years ago, but we're going to go ahead and give you 7 episodes over the course of 2 years. You know, 14 episodes over the course of 2 years.
That's a way to get some DVD sales, I guess.
Yeah, and you can look at... Yeah. And you can also look at this another way. It can also be the actors might have wanted to be done with this as well. But hey, you know what? 2 seasons worth. They're getting 2 seasons out of it. And meanwhile, you're going to see Anson Mount and all these other actors, Cole Meany, they're going to be moving on to other projects, if not be in other television shows, while this show is still airing.
Yeah.
Because 2 years is a long time. But Anson Mount has made a name for himself off Hell on Wheels. He will have another job in a matter of months. Guaranteed. Like, by the time they're done wrapping the fifth season, he will be brought on to either a movie, a big film, or another TV series, for sure.
Well, and they're all good actors in the show.
Oh, yeah, oh,
I mean,
for sure.
You know, I think any show that's going to get even Ruth, I mean, they're all fantastic. Eva.
Yeah.
Haven't seen her much. So I forgot her already.
Well, you know, and that comes into some of my issues that I'm having with this season. I just feel like some of the characters have been lost. Like, yes, this is one of the better seasons we've had, but also at the same time, some of the characters are being kind of lost within the murky storylines. And I'm not saying murky in a negative way. It's kind of hard to pinpoint what the main story is this year. And I think that's another problem people are having with the fact that, hey, you know what, this season has moved so slow, and now we're going to have only one more season, you know? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, and also look at, they're killing characters off. That can also be because of the fact that they need to move on and get this final season, a final salute and send off the series on a positive note.
You hope they do that. You hope they put it goes off on a positive note.
Yeah, let's not have a Deadwood ending, you know, because Deadwood's arguably one of the best television shows ever to grace the airwaves, but it also had probably the worst ending ever in history of television.
Because there was no ending.
Exactly. Exactly. And you know what? Hey, you know what? Maybe we can appreciate the fact that John Worth and AMC's at least giving us that. They could have just ended it right now.
Yep.
And we would have had yet another Deadwood, you know, scenario. So, all right. So Hell on Wheels star, Kasha Kropinski. I hope I'm not pronouncing that wrong. I'm terrible with name, but let's say Kasha,
KK.
Kropinski. Yeah. KKK. So stupid. No, that'd be terrible. Kasha Kropinski talks Ruth's choice. Now this is a spoiler. Okay. Everybody out there. But the November 15th episode of AMC's Hell on Wheels, 13 Steps, found preacher Ruth, determined to see herself hanged for murdering Sidney Snow. Did you find out Ruth would, this is a question from EW, did you find out Ruth would be killed off at the start of the season? Kropinski said, no, I had no idea this would be happening to Ruth until about, I suppose, the last quarter of the season. That's when I found out the news. Either it was a huge surprise or I'm just incredibly naive and don't pay attention. Ruth killing Sidney was the first action she's ever taken in her life, or at least what we've seen of her on the show for the past 4 years. Ruth killing Sidney was the first action she's ever taken in her life. I don't know. I mean, she stood up to her. I mean, I don't want to argue with her. She knows her character better than I do, but she stood up to her father, did she not?
You know, wasn't being it kind more of a scare? Like she was scared?
Maybe. You know? I mean, she also, you know, willingly, you know, got plowed by the Native American dude. I mean, that was an action she took.
Yeah, she did.
So, I mean, I think that's an action, right?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that's saying something. Maybe he was a terrible lay. Maybe she doesn't consider any action.
Yeah, she's like, this doesn't count.
Yeah, no, I'm a virgin still. So dumb. So something as monumentous and seismic as that had to create a bit of a drama, and when that drama results in her demise. So, and they also say, went on to say, did executive producer John Worth explain why he wanted to take the story in this direction? She says, I don't know if John said this to me in confidence, but he basically said he wasn't sure what he would do with Ruth going forward. He said to me, I feel like you'll just be marginalized and have one scene in an episode and just talk to Colin every now and then, and that's not going to be very interesting or exciting or worth your time. Okay. There you have it. It's just what I just said. They killed her basically because they wanted to bring relevance to her character.
I see that.
I don't know if that's a good thing, though. I mean, I mean, you've had a character sit here for 4 years, and instead of giving her some interesting storylines, you're saying as a writer that you can't?
So, well,
I mean, you can also look at that as that's what you need to do. If there's a character that's no longer interesting and no longer adding to the plot, what do?
Right.
You shoot. You kill her. You get him out of the storyline. If you want to look at it that way, couldn't you also say that about Eva? Even though I love Eva to death, I mean, it's all over the internet. People kind of don't know where Eva's character is at and what's her point anymore. So, I mean, you could also say the same thing about Eva.
True.
You know? Yeah, so,
you can almost see her next.
Yeah. Although, I mean, look, you know, again, I'm playing devil's advocate here. That's my job on the show. But, I mean, let's justify for John Worth as well for a moment. I mean, the fact that he doesn't want to marginalize her character is also saying a lot. He's also saying, listen, your character has run its course. If we keep you around, we feel like you'll be lost. And your character will be lost and watered down and will have no relevance to the story. And in essence, all your 4 years of putting into the show will bear no meaning in the end. This way, your character goes off on a high note. People remember you. And again, let's remember, Bohannon is the focus. And everything that happens should actually help aid in his development as a person and a character. And one thing that I would say, by doing something like this, it definitely does. Right? Would you agree or no?
Yes. Well, because they, you know, I think in that article they even mentioned that Snow was his devil on his shoulder and she was the saint on his shoulder.
Right.
And so, I mean, when you read that, you kind of go, okay, you know, that's from the past, or Sidney Snow is from the past, his war days. And they kind of talked about them shooting in that hospital.
Yeah.
And then you've got Ruth, who kind of really brought him to humanize him, I guess, is what I was trying to say. Uh-huh. And trying to make him more of a normal guy instead of this outlaw and this killer. And when they, it even said that in that article, when they both died, that's it.
Yeah. It's true. You know what? On that note, Clint, we do need to go to a quick break. We're going to come back and we're going to jump in and we're going to break down this episode. There's a lot of good things this episode that we can get into. We'll be right back.
From Lisburg to Danville in a line on a 3-mile grade. It was on that grade that he lost his air brake, so you see what a jump he made.
Don't y'all go nowhere. Weird West Radio will be right back.
Masturbates in hockey penalty box. Mom complains in a Dear Prudence advice column.
That's 5 minutes.
Yeah, penalty.
He's constantly getting penalized, dude.
Penalized.
Major penalty, 5 minutes.
Like so during a game? Or
yeah.
Like...
Oh, wow. That's ballsy. 10 minutes.
Yeah.
10 minutes.
Wow. I hope they got the power play.
So, the coach is like, listen, son, you need to quit high-sticking the players. I'm like, I can't. I can't stop.
Like, so did he whip it out and, like, just
yeah, here,
go
I gotta
for it?
Hear. All right.
Slashing for 2 minutes.
Aw. Hooking? What about hooking?
Yeah, hooking! So stupid. A guy finds a very valuable magic card and goes nuts.
I saw this on YouTube.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God, it's titties.
Oh, holy.
It's titties.
Yeah. No, that's better than tits right now.
That's an album freaking Lotus. That's a... Holy.
Excuse me?
Why are people getting so excited?
Honestly, though, my question is, how important is this card for 27,000
seasons? What does it do? Can we look it up and, like, see the magic powers it has? Like, does it freeze the whole, like... Does it freeze, like, your whole, like, deck or something?
Should I send a distress signal to
Does
Brian?
Does it freeze your whole deck? But you can tell you don't know anything about magic cards.
Should I send a distress signal to
Excuse me, Maggie. I can tell you know nothing about magic cards.
Oh, excuse me. Excuse me.
You can only freeze the whole deck with a magical Whopper Stopper card.
The Rain Man Show. Every week on Rain Man Digital. Go to rainmanwashere.com for more details.
Hey, ass butt.
What about Plucky, the ones you guys hate? Is
that was Gamble.
Was that Gamble?
That was season 7, yeah.
Okay.
So I don't really, at least not that immediately comes to mind, Carver has not had one that was a funny episode, that was just full-on episode. Hilarity, yeah. Which he's had a lot of great lines, especially with Crowley.
Does Bloodlines count?
Yeah. Does Bloodlines count?
That was damn funny.
That's funny now.
That was at a comedy?
That was funny. Oh, poor Enos. Oh,
sad.
That was Enos walking away from the Bloodlines.
This is when the CW execs pulled Enos into the office. He's all, listen, yeah, I didn't go over well, so take a fucking walk.
This is Lou Ferrigno, and I love Bloodlines.
Oh, my God.
I'm Lou Ferrigno, and I approve this message.
I'm going to cry.
We're going to die in hell.
Oh, already got a one-way ticket, man.
Yeah.
You meet Crowley, right?
Yeah.
Don't miss the all-new Supernatural fan show, The Crossroads. Available on Stitcher and iTunes. Search The Crossroads.
Don't miss a very special Star Wars From the Back to Tank. When we welcome John Jackson Miller, the writer of the Star Wars Rebels prequel, Star Wars A New Dawn.
It's not the new EU because the old EU was never canon according to the way that they've described things.
Okay. Yeah.
And the thing is, I wasn't approached to do that. I was approached to write a novel that would be a prequel to the Rebels TV series that would be set in between Episode 3 and Rebels, you know, telling about the Empire in this period and what it was like to live in this time, and also showing the first meeting of the two Rebels principals.
Yeah.
But there wasn't anything about any change to the process, or rather any change to the canon, described to me then. And why did they do this? It's very simple. It's because they want to make sure that they have as much room when they're making these new movies, not just 7, 8, 9, but also the standalone movies that they're talking about doing. Yeah, they need to have as much freedom to tell the best story that they can.
Yes.
Go to RainManWasHere.com for more details.
y'all listening to Weird West Radio on Rain Man Digital.
All right, we are back. Hell on Wheels, the Weird West Radio Hell on Wheels edition on Rain Man Digital. Clint, I don't know if you know this, but you can now find all of our shows on Stitcher Smart Radio. All you got to do is just search Weird West Radio. Were you aware of that?
What?
What?
Oh, you're such a giving person.
Oh, such a seamless plug, Clint. Such a seamless plug. But, all right, so let's just jump into this. All right, so 13 Steps. We're going to be breaking down that episode now, 13 Steps. Colin grapples with Ruth's unexpected decision. Louise jeopardizes her reputation to fight for a story she believes in. Now, we find ourselves immediately thrown into kind of like a court. Ruth is accused unlawfully, basically, of shooting Sidney Snow. Two mortal wounds, and he asked to respond to the charges. Ruth unexpectedly answers guilty. Now, did you see her doing that? You just wanting to accept her guilt?
Well, when she got put in jail, she closed that cell door, and yeah. I thought she was just going to accept whatever came at her.
Right.
Excuse me. And then we kind of went back into her history with her father and him doing, and she seemed like she felt guilty about all that anyway.
Yeah.
And then
did you think that flashback they put into last episode, do you think that played a lot of part in her decision for this episode?
I think so. I think she felt a little guilty about the whole thing.
Well, yeah, I think, you know, she in a sense, she last episode, you know, particularly, I think, you know, I think she had to look at herself in the mirror and say, okay, did I just take, you know, God's justice, God's, you know, God's job into my own hands, much like my father did? And if we remember correctly, she did not like her father very much. She viewed him as a very mean, malicious person. So I'm wondering if that's part of the reason why she wanted to accept her guilt. Not only was it the fact that I think she wanted to give credence to her shooting Snow, and I think that if she said, no, I'm not guilty, it would take away from her revenge that she felt Snow deserved. And maybe this is her coming to terms that she is her father's daughter as well, because she felt no resentment, you know, much like her father. And maybe she realized, listen, this is what needed to be done. I am my father's daughter, and so be it.
Yep.
She almost like she accepted her fate, in a sense.
Very much so.
So I did like that connection there. I don't think she's as twisted and evil as her father was. Her father was fucked in the head.
He had issues.
Yeah, so I don't think she's that, but I think she saw that in her to a lesser degree. But at the same time, I feel like she did want to take this guilt, because if she took the pardon, I think she was, it would take away from Ezra's death. I think she felt that way. Like, it, you know, like, okay, you know, I think she wanted this to, I think it would take the legitimacy of what she did by shooting Snow away from her. It would take it away by her saying, no, I want to be pardoned.
Exactly.
Like, no, I'm going to have the power. I'm in control. I willingly took this man's life, and now I'm willingly going to go make sure I pay for this so that it means something. Because think about it. If she just got away with it, would it mean as much to her? Possibly?
If she got to walk away?
Right.
Yeah, I don't think she would feel like she was even close to being vindicated.
Right, exactly.
I think in a personal sense, she felt vindicated shooting Snow and killing her son's killer.
Right.
As any parent would want anyway.
Right.
And then she was like, my son is gone. My church is gone. I have nothing. Well, and her man is gone because, you know, we find out later that he had the hots for Colin.
Yeah. And same thing. I mean, you know, and I think we all wanted her to take, you know, Bohannon's basically eyewitness statement of, she was aiding and abetting, you know, basically aiding a officer of the law and shooting down a criminal. I mean, that would have held up in any court of law. You know, it, to this day, that probably would have held up. But again, I just kind of reaffirming what we were saying is that I think if she allowed that to be pawned off, I think publicly, again, it would take away from the meaning of what she did. So I admire her in a lot of ways. I mean, especially when she was walking to that noose and she could keep on. I mean, because I'll be honest right now, man. I mean, I would quickly justify. I would quickly find a way to get out of that noose. You know, you might want to think that you wouldn't. You would be as brave as her. But just think about it, man. She had 13 steps. Ping! She had 13 steps to make a decision all night long. She had time to make the decision to say no, and she did not say no. And I don't think any of us could you know, honestly say that we wouldn't say yes. I was helping Bohannon. That's exactly what I was doing.
Yeah,
you know, I mean, there's a governor's pardon as well. I mean, who wouldn't jump at that?
And
you know,
really, Campbell, even he was. I thought he was kind of cool through this episode.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He did present it twice, and then he would even accept her pardon. And he, you know, he didn't really want to do this,
right?
Yet he had to do this.
He has to maintain a sense of power and justice in that town. Otherwise, as you can see, you know, one little thing could just send the townspeople into a frenzy and start, you know, a lack of better words, a riot.
Yeah.
You know, and I think he's trying. I think Campbell's finally understanding the way this town works. I think he came from a different area. He was used to a different type of thing. He was used to, hey, I say it and it gets done. And that's that. And I think slowly he's realized that he has to kind of almost play the Seth Bullock position from Deadwood, where, you know what, I'm going to maintain my morals and my laws, but I'm going to have to bend a little bit. Otherwise, it's not going to work in a town like this.
Yeah.
And I think you see him kind of understanding the way things work now, for sure, with Campbell. And you know what? It's funny because you see a character like Campbell being introduced this season. And what did you expect? I thought he for sure was going to be the antagonist this season. And he really isn't. He isn't the bad guy. I mean, he's definitely thrown the storyline through some hoops and some hurdles, but when you break it down, he isn't really the villain of the story.
No, but on the same hand, I think you and I even said he was kind of pukey in the beginning.
Right.
And yes. Now when we kind of had this whole thing happen, he's only trying. He is kind of fair. I mean, unfortunately, you got to hand it to him on this one that he was more fair than I think we've ever seen him.
Right.
And
he pretty much willingly gave in on every when it came to the hanging. I mean, the woman wants to die. You know, and in a lot of ways, I think he was just in that aspect. And I think even in the end, Bohannon became just as well and realized this is her decision. This is what she wants. Don't take that final thing away from her. At least give her that. You know, and who knows, man? Can you imagine losing a kid? Maybe we would want to die as well if our kids died. You know, I hate even saying that. I don't think I'd want to be alive if my kid died. You know what I mean? That's a terrible thought.
It's a very dark thought. On the same hand, you know, when you consider how he died, when it's by the hands of Sidney Snow or the guy who killed your family member, your son or your kid, and you finally get that retribution. Unfortunately, it doesn't take away the pain that your kid's gone. You
right.
know, yeah, you feel good. He's not here no more. I've just killed the killer, but yet I'm still with this hole in my being, and you don't know what to do. So yeah, I could see where Ruth would just be like, you know what, I am done, I'm spent, I don't want this anymore.
Yeah. So going back to Campbell's, you know, not being the true antagonist, I think that is, you know, again, going off of what Reddit has been saying and Facebook, I think it's a bit jolting to certain viewers that there is no discernible antagonist this season. I mean, you have the overarching enemy, the villain, I think the nemesis, which is the Swede. And I think if you looked at what's coming up for next season, I think he's involved possibly in what's happening to Bohanna's family. It might be. Mm-hmm. But I think that might, just looking at this objectively, not because I'm a huge fan of Helen Wheels, but let's look at this objectively. And Campbell was, I think, introduced as the antagonist. He slowly became the guy who's not really the antagonist. And I think it threw a lot of people off because they no longer know who to root for. Who do I root for? Campbell actually has become a decent individual, has proven that he's chivalrous for the most part. You know, he actually treats women with respect as well. He probably treats women with more respect than anybody else in that town when you really break it down, you know, which fits his character. If you know history, Campbell, again, as we said before, was responsible for, you know, helping women have voting rights, you know, later in history. So it, they're being true to his character, which I was kind of wondering, remember how, okay, if this guy's the bad guy, how are they going to deal with that fact that he's actually a pretty decent guy in history, supposedly?
Yeah.
And, you know, and I guess, you know, Campbell has had a pretty good arc this season when you really want to break him down. He might even now, if you really break down, since this season's coming to an end, you might even say that Campbell might be the best written character this season. Just everything, his interaction with everybody, he's the one character that's pretty much interacted in almost every plot point this season.
Yeah, he really has.
If you realize, he's touched on every single storyline. I even like the connection with him and Louise now, which I did not like. Remember, we were both kind of disturbed by it at first?
Yeah.
They won me over, and I was surprised. Like, I'm like, I like what they have now, because it is real. Remember, we were debating whether or not she was using him, you know, but it was real. I think it was curiosity on her part, you know? And it turned into something that I think they have a mutual respect for each other. But I love that. I love that they both obviously care about each other, but they're also going to stand their ground on their beliefs.
Especially when she's going to write a not so flattering news article about them.
Right.
Which I was kind of surprised.
You know what? Would you have liked her if she didn't? You know what I mean? Like, I would have lost respect for her if she didn't stick to her guns. I mean, you can't get some dick and be like, and throw caution to the wind. Oh, God, I got some dick. I forget everything I believe in. Come on. if only there was real women like that in real life.
Oh, wow.
Give me the D and I'll just forget about everything you've ever done.
I'll vote however you want me to.
Yeah. No, man. I mean, it wouldn't be realistic. So I like that they're making her a true-to-life character without any actual agendas, like, oh, I'm a strong woman. No, they're just making her be real. They're making a realistic character.
And she does seem very, one of the most realistic ones on the show, to be quite honest.
Yeah, 100%. And she has, in a matter of this season, she has actually become one of the more interesting characters. And she's fairly new, and to me, she's more developed now than any other female, even Ruth, at this point. So maybe, you know, I'm thinking they have some big plans for her next season, unless they decide to kill her next week.
Put her in the printing press. Too much?
Yeah, a
bit.
Oh,
come on.
So stupid, yeah. So Colin and Ruth, I thought that was a really good scene that was needed. It actually fixed some plot issues as well that might have been there from last year. They actually discussed what was going on, because I think a lot of people were like, wait a second, is there something going on with Ruth and Bohannon? Was there? Is there? Is it going to happen? And they answered it for you.
But didn't, I mean, not to, you know, talk highly of us, but didn't we both say that she had a thing for Bohannon?
Yeah, and I think it was pretty evident, yes.
Especially when they even mentioned it. She even mentioned it when they were in the cell, when the three, the baby, right, and I forgot the other, his wife's name, showed up in the town.
Naomi.
How she felt, you know, she felt broken. So it was, and it goes right back to her death, is that, you know, she got to spill her guts. Cullen's gone. Her son is gone. The church is gone. I mean, at that point, later.
Yeah. So I really did like their connection, and you know, I think this is just adding to Bohanna's character for the final season. I mean, the guilt that must lay on this guy's chest, man. The fact that everything's put on him.
Yeah. Poor bastard.
You know, I mean, even when she said, you know, I wanted to leave this town and I stayed because of you. I mean, oh, dude, I mean, that's got to hurt if you're Bohanna. I'm like, shit. I mean, Ezra could have been alive. She wouldn't be where she's at right now if it wasn't, you know, for me playing, you know, dick baiting her. I'm like, waving my penis in front of you. Stay here with me. And then I come back and I marry somebody else.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean, that's some guilt that he's got to live with now. I mean, he's got guilt just stacking up on him, man. He's guilty for his original wife and child being killed. You know, I mean, he feels guilty about Naomi and the baby, about Common's character, you know, being killed
off.
Well,
Eva's never going to let him forget that or this.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah. And now Eva, you know, is never going to forgive him. He also has to deal with the fact that, I forgot his name, Don Norwood's character, the big guy. What's his name? I forgot his name now.
Psalms.
Psalms. Even, I mean, he has to deal with the fact that Psalms, you know, has some resentment towards him. I mean, and now Ruth. And when you think about it, I mean, Bohanna's done nothing but he's done everything good by these people, and yet he has just this guilt that he has to walk around with, you know. And he's a good guy, man. I mean, he sat there. I again, getting back to their discussion, I think it really fleshed out some issues with some questions that we had. She pretty much said she did love him. She cared about him. She should have said it sooner. You know, she didn't. You know, life regrets that we all have. Right at the end, you know, Bohannon having to basically come to terms with his family. Like, what does this mean? When she said, you have your family, I think it meant a lot, that conversation. And I think it brought back, you know, kind of a bit of a realization that, hey, what am I doing here? Like, I am slaving away on this railroad, and I'm ignoring my family. For what? For what? You know, and I think I like that Ruth laid out questions for him, and her actions and the reasons behind her actions led to Bohannon's conclusions and his decisions.
Well,
I think it made him open his eyes and realize and kind of question. Could we all come to that a little bit when something happens drastic in our lives? We start questioning the validity of what we're doing and whether or not it's, you know, worth it. Like, what's more important in the end?
Oh, exactly. And I think she even said that family, you're never wrong with family in the cell, didn't she?
Yeah.
But yeah. Then when he was out working on the big steam press, the dredge machine, and I forgot his name, comes out, his boss.
Delaney? Oh, yeah.
Okay. I know
what you mean.
What's that?
Cole Meany.
He comes out.
Durant.
And he even says, do you know where I was when my son died of cholera? And he's like, And he goes, either do I. You know, he was just that busy. And I think that kind of set into Cullen's head too a little bit. Like, I don't want to be these people.
Yeah. Dude, and that's another thing. You brought up Durant. I mean, I really, really, really like the community feeling that they're doing this season finally. Like, enough of the internal squabbles. You know, there's so many issues they have internally or from the outside. Why are we squabbling from the inside? And I really like that this season they brought them together, the entire railroad, together as a community, and realized that this is kind of an immediate family. You know, like, and I like that that Campbell has, or not Campbell, Durant has become something that he hasn't done before or been before. He's a decent man this season as well.
Well, when he came out with the candle in the crowd.
Yeah, the fact that he cared about that, which, dude, he would have done that, ever. No. You know, he comes out, he shows his respect. The fact that he even went out and gave counsel, like actual legitimate wisdom to Bohannon, which... Durant's not a dummy. He's never has been dumb, but he's too arrogant and selfish to ever part his wisdom to anybody. And I think the fact that he willingly went out there and gave some choice words to Bohannon that were relevant and had meaning, it shows how much he's changed since the first season as a person.
Now, my thought when I saw that after, I was like, oh, that's really a cool moment between Durant and Cullen.
It's great.
Then
yeah.
I kind of thought to myself, Durant just wants his effing railroad get going, so go in there, comfort her so we can hang her and we can get going again.
Yeah, you know what? I thought that too, but honestly, I really do think he's being, I think he's being a human being for once and not an asshole, you know? So, I mean, you can't have Campbell be a nice guy and leave Durant as the arrogant dick. So, I mean, I just really like the only characters that are a bit murky is Mickey and his cousin. What is this, Shay? I want to say his cousin's name is Shay.
I don't know.
I mean, even last episode, you saw him gouge the guy's eyes out, and Mickey was like, that had that look of, oh shit, what did I just bring into this town? Like, it was almost like instant, like, what the fuck did I do?
Yeah.
Like, I just unleashed, you know, I just opened the gate here, you know, and I have no collar to put back on this guy, no leash to put back on him.
I just thought it was awesome. He looks at him and he says, I love you because you're my cousin, but I don't work for you.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, do you think this is going to bite Mickey in the ass in the end? Like, do you think that it's going to go down a route that he didn't want it to go down?
Oh, I think so. I would assume so. I think it already did once he pulled that eye out.
Yeah.
I mean, he knows.
Yeah.
I think he knows that since he set that precedence in the casino, that if he's by his side, anything can go. And I think Campbell's smart enough to know that he doesn't want to push too many boundaries. Otherwise, Mickey's not going to go off the handle, but his cousin probably will.
I have a feeling that his cousin, if Mickey did try to stop him or say, dude, calm down, I have a feeling he would just turn on him. Like, he's a loose cannon.
Yeah.
Like, I have a pretty good feeling that Mickey's aware of that. That, okay, if I try to stop him, he's going to kill me because I brought him out here to basically help us restore some type of, at the time, an injustice. But I think if Mickey would have waited a couple days, I don't think he would have ended up, you know, sending that telegram off to get his cousins here. So, yeah, I think in the end, Mickey will end up kind of regretting his decision. And it might end up being his downfall. Who knows? What if he ends up dying, too, for whatever reason? Because of this decision. I mean, I can't imagine Bohannon, who does like Mickey, kind of like understanding his decision to bring in yet another loose cannon into this town like Sidney Snow.
Yeah, it's a dangerous, it's like having a gun with a hair trigger on it. You can only put your fingers, you can only squeeze so much, and then it'll just go off. And I think this is one of those characters or guys that will, like you said, he probably would go after Mickey. So maybe that will be the the surprise shocker of these last couple episodes. One episode?
Yeah.
Two episodes.
One more episode, yeah. You know, jumping into this final scene, let's get bringing it back to Ruth. I must say, man, John Worth is just a superior filmmaker, dude. And when it comes to anything that the showrunners did before him, the stuff we see in these episodes are just, when it comes to visuals, are just fantastic. I mean, the choices in sound design, the choices in cinematography, the shot choices, fantastic. I mean, the entire scene leading up from Ruth walking the 13 steps, you know, just the hangman being so polite, so unexpected. You always expect hangmen, you know, to be assholes and dicks, but this guy was such a gentleman. It brought a whole other level of scariness.
It was
the fact that he wasn't the traditional, like, yeah, I want to hang you.
Yeah.
I'm going to hang you real good. Like, this guy was a polite gentleman, much like probably more realistic to the times. It was a job.
Yep.
You know, it wasn't like some guy's enjoyment to do this, like we see in a lot of Westerns. You know, when you break it down, it was just another job at that time. And it showed, it just kind of brought a human quality to this scene, I guess you could say. And it just added to her death that much more to me.
I think the attention to detail is what really surprised me about the whole hangman thing. He was explaining it to her, you know. 13 steps, 5 minutes, you know, I put the noose over you. You know, he went through the detail so nothing would be a surprise to her. And the attention to detail for this episode, for sure, was just phenomenal.
What about the son when he's all like, my pa ain't never had to hang somebody twice.
Yeah, and I didn't quite...
I would have been pissed. I'm like, shut up, you little shit.
Yeah, he seemed a little adopted, like, didn't he?
Like, he didn't, that would have scared me even more. Like, my pa never had to hang, basically saying that he kills people real good.
Yeah.
You know, like, he never had to hang anybody twice. Like, oh shit. I don't think that comforted her very much.
Yeah.
Okay, one of my favorite scenes of all time in a movie is that scene in Kill Bill where Uma's put into the coffin, and you have just the nails in the darkness going and the sounds of the shovel dropping the dirt on the wood coffin. And that's all you hear for a good 5 minutes, pretty much, which is ballsy because you're never supposed to leave an audience in blackness for that long. But all you hear is the sound, and it's so perfect, man. It just adds to the fear. And this scene with Ruth, when they put the hood on her, that was a good 45 seconds, I want to say, maybe 30 at the least. And man, that was so powerful of a scene. They executed that, no pun intended. they executed that scene fantastic. I mean, we didn't need to see her drop.
No, we've seen it. We've seen it many times. It doesn't need to be done.
Right, but the inside of the hood of, you can't see anything except maybe through the little tears in the cloth. You know, the breathing is so much more closer and consuming. You know, you're getting hot. I could feel the heat of the breath almost, man. That's how good it was done.
I love that the breath or the panting escalated. I thought that was super.
So good. Man, Ruth, man. She. I have to admit, you know, I gave her a little shit when she killed Sydney Snow, but any qualms I had about her acting ability in that one particular scene was instantly fixed in this episode. I mean, she did great.
Yeah.
Even in discussion, like the laughing story about the shit, how she fell in shit.
Go ahead.
So good.
I was gonna ask, did you notice that when they did that, you know, before they started doing the conversation, now maybe it was just me that I was enthralled in the conversation, but the hammering seemed to stop until they've kind of rested on their story. Like their story was done, then the hammering started again.
Yeah, I did notice that. I wasn't sure what they were trying to do unless maybe they thought it was too obnoxious for the audience to listen to the whole entire time while they're telling a story.
See,
so I don't know if it was done for any aesthetic reasons or if it was done intentionally to
take you away from the moment, like, or the what's happening.
Right. So it doesn't distract us from the conversation.
I was just curious if it really was on the show.
I'm not sure. I mean, it could be for many things. I mean, personally, I probably would have kept it on at a very low volume. But who knows? It might have maybe they tested it with an audience and they're like, wow, that's really distracting, dude. And it takes away from the scene. So maybe that's what they did. Who knows? Now let's talk about that final scene, which I was actually talking to a friend of mine about this. Now, Anson Mount has always been a pretty damn good actor, but the acting chops that he has shown this season, I mean, John Worth really knows how to work with him. Really knows how to work with him because he's always been a decent actor. We've always liked him. But this season, his abilities, I mean, he has shined. He has shined. I mean, even in the most littlest instances, like the end of this past episode, where he's hanging out. You know, he walks into Durant's, you know, tent. Durant's talking to him. He doesn't say anything. And he just gets this face where it just, everything makes sense. And he's all, I quit.
Yeah.
And that was so easy, so simple, yet so powerful the way that was delivered, because his face, you believed it. You had a sense of he finally realized what's more important.
Well, and he took that big, deep breath. Like we all would when we go in to quit a job. I mean, if you felt entitled to the job and you just, I quit. You know, and I thought it was pretty good.
I mean, God, it was fantastic. I mean, on so many levels, it was good. I mean, not just the quitting aspect, but it was like it was hard for him because I think the railroad is his band-aid to his emotional problems. I think that's why he cares so much about this railroad, is because of the fact that it's a band-aid dealing with his wife's. I mean, it brought his issues with his wife and son being killed led him to the railroad. Since then, he's been through the mill over and over and over, and I think his way to deal with it is by keeping busy. And I think having the railroad helps him deal. And I think it was almost a frightful thought if he doesn't have it. And I think that's almost why he took that breath and was like, I need to get over this. I need to go find my family. I need to be with them. That's what's important. I'm not going to let Ruth, you know, final talk with me just roll right off my back. It needs to mean something. And I almost think that's what it was. I think he took the Band-Aid off. You know, he took the crutches and threw them away and said, I got to deal with life. I got to deal with what's right in front of me and not use this work anymore, which we've already seen him. Look what he did as soon as Common died. What did he do?
Right back to work.
When Elam died, he went right back to work. And that's what he was doing again. And I think he didn't want to get stuck in that rut. He's like, you know what? Ruth is right. I need to go to my family. It was so, I mean, that's exactly what I got. I just spoke for 2 minutes and I got 2 minutes of content from 15 seconds of acting. It's brilliant. And that's one thing I got to say about this season for sure is the acting has just went through the roof for on everybody's level, particularly with Bohannon. So, anyways, any final thoughts on this before we need to move on? You want to give a grade, and then we'll move on to the second segment. We'll talk about next week's episode and what to expect.
I enjoyed the whole episode beforehand, and coming up to this one, which I think they both they definitely needed each other so we could kill Snow. But I like the build up to the hanging, and I'm going to go 4.5 just because I think everybody did a fantastic job. And like I said, the detail to this episode was amazing to me. 4.5 shots.
Yeah. 4.5. Look at you. Get drunk.
Party.
On 4 shots.
Carry me home.
You're lightweight. Yeah.
Lightweight.
All right. Well, let's see. My final thoughts. All right. I think it kind of gave them a little bit throughout the show this week, but I'm going to go ahead and give this episode, I think I'm going to agree with you.
Oh.
You know what? I'm going to give it 4 shots. You know what? I think I got to give it 4.5 shots as well.
You just don't want to agree with me, do you?
Well, I got to give it 4.5 shots. And for a couple reasons, for a lot of reasons, actually, I think this episode is probably my second favorite episode of the season so far, right after the Elam episode. That was my favorite, not the one where he was, you know, daydreaming all day or the entire episode, but the second one with Elam where he dies. That was such a powerful episode. This was a powerful episode. I always felt like it was going to be hard. In fact, I mentioned this a couple shows ago. It would be hard for them to beat the emotional reaction that Bohannon had with Elam's death. And I think they matched it in a different way. Yeah, there wasn't the tears and the grief, but they were able to capture that in a much different way. Like, her death meant something slightly different to him than Elam's. And just the emotional guilt that keeps weighing on him, on Bohannon, the writing of this episode, the acting from everybody. I love the development of Campbell's character and Louise. I think this episode was almost a catalyst and a conclusion to saying, hey, look, this is what we did this season. These are our characters moving forward. We built the ones that we are going to continue on with, and we've killed the ones and gave them due just the ones that we can no longer move on with. You know, and whether we want to agree with the death scenes or not, they're being done pretty damn well. That being said, I think my only issue is the non-antagonist that we have this season. And I have to agree in part. I don't think it's detrimental. but it is hard for some audiences to deal with a show where there is no visible antagonist, where there's just the real antagonist is just the situations that are happening from episode to episode. Maybe they did that this season to take a break from the Swede, so that next season he comes back full on badass bad guy. Who knows? So we shall see. So four and a half shots this week, and we'll be right back, Clint.
Okay.
Don't go nowhere, everybody. We'll be right back. So stupid. All right.
Don't y'all go nowhere. Weird West Radio will be right back.
Men attempt to rescue a group of captives from a band of cannibalistic men that live on the edge of civilization.
Dark.
That is very extreme. I mean, dude, cannibalism is dark right there. You can't do a happy, ho-hum, John Wayne-esque type Western, you know, with a cannibal, with the word cannibal in the synopsis. I might even dare say that this might be a Weird West, just based on that plot line alone. We're getting some really backwater mentality type people. You know, I'm talking kill your mother, stuff her under the bed, and then roll her out to have sex with her type mentality. I mean, that's Whoa. Just yeah, that's X-Files shit right there.
That's playing with your food before you eat it. That's
oh,
gross.
Oh man. Yeah. Never mind the incestual side of it, Clint.
Listen up, cowboys and cowgirls. You can now listen to Weird West Radio every Sunday. Only on Rain Man Digital.
He
died. He probably
he dead.
Himself.
Okay. And, all right. So he emptied his body. Empty.
Right. And so they throw him in the back of the truck. Then they drive around for a while looking for a place to dump the body.
Wow.
They dump the body. Somebody finds it. Right. Now, here's how the two got caught, though, because when they dumped the body, they had no idea who did it or anything. But they posted the selfie picture on their Facebook page. So they take a picture with their boy.
With the guy dead.
Well, passed out at least.
Hashtag he's just passed out.
Right. Probably dead. And according to the police.
Hashtag he's only sleeping.
According to the police, what he says is, well, he appeared certainly to be deceased. That's what the cop said. Now, know your boy OD.
I just like the generation that we live in. Like, hey, there's always time for a selfie now.
I mean, that's just ridiculous.
Hey, our friend just died. But guess what?
But
we got to do a selfie. Like, hashtag no shame.
The Rain Man Show. Every week on Rain Man Digital. Go to rainmanwashere.com for more details.
Adam and Eve. AdamandEve.com. Everybody should be going to AdamandEve.com. Right now, they are giving out 10 free gifts. They're giving you 10 free gifts with your first purchase. You buy one item at the regular price, and you get 10 free items, plus a sexy surprise for her, adventurous new toy for him, a plus 6 full-length DVDs. So you buy one item, you get 10 free gifts, a sexy surprise for her, an adventurous toy for him, and 6 full-length DVDs. Also, they'll be paying for your shipping, so there is no shipping. All you do is buy one item. Go to AdamandEve.com, and at checkout, enter DEAL30. Okay, let's see. Let's jump into this final
bit. That was fucking funny, man. This is long pause. I thought, okay, he's doing something. And we'll be right back.
Let's see. Do I drone on too much with my final thoughts, dude?
Am I too short? How's that?
I don't know. I guess it complements each other, I guess. All right, let's move in this final bit. All right, we are back. Weird West Radio, the Hell and Wheels edition. We're going to cover a few things. We're going to talk about the upcoming episode Further West, briefly discuss what we might expect from the episode, and then we're going to jump into what Reddit says about last week's episode as well. So first off, this will be the season finale. As the Further West, as the railroad prepares to leave Cheyenne behind after Sherman Peak, Colin returns to Fort Smith to get his family. So, I mean, pretty simplistic storyline, but as we saw in the preview, anything can happen in this final episode at this point. I've given up trying to speculate exactly what John Worth is going to do because it seems like we can never quite figure it out.
Yeah, no kidding.
I mean, he definitely takes us for a roller coaster ride and doesn't give away the goods too soon so we can't figure it out. There is a lot of mystery in his episodes. But what do you think we're going to see, Clint? I mean, just obviously we may not be right, but let's speculate a bit. What do you think we're going to see next episode?
Well, it looks like there was... I'm just going off with that five-second little preview that I had. And I think the camp is kind of gone. Like, it was raided. So... you know, I'm only speculating that it could be the suite again, but you just never know. I, like you said, it's really tough to speculate on how this show has been going because I don't know how often we've been right. But
yeah,
you know, it looked, it was kind of neat to see him head back there, but he was holding a guy with his head all bandaged up or bloody or something, so. I really don't know.
Yeah, good analysis. Yeah, I'm there.
Clint. Half retarded.
I really don't know.
I'm as simple as the little hangman right. Kid.
Oh, Oh man, that was good. Oh man, I don't know. I'm not sure. I think this the episode here. Obviously, judging by what we saw in the preview here, his wife is going to be missing. They may be just baiting us a bit, but it does look like possibly Swede is involved. We still obviously we know Brigham Young is a bit shady. He's not up, you know, he's not on the up and up completely. So we don't really know yet what Brigham Young and the Swede have in plan. And for what that's worth, we don't even know really what the Swede has planned and what he's actually doing with Brigham Young. I'm sure the guy has the wheels are turning and he's really trying to figure something out. And he might even already have it planned of what he's going to be doing. So I think that those plans are going to be brought to fruition. I think we're going to be made known. It's going to be made known what the Swede has in store, what the plan is going to be, and what we're going to see a little bit into next season. And I honestly don't think we're going to find Bohannon's family. I think it's going to end with his family missing.
Big cliffhanger.
And that's going to be the lead into next season.
Have we had a big cliffhanger with Hell on Wheels? Like something where we're like, can't wait for next year?
I'm trying to remember. Let me see. I think the only thing we had that was kind of close was when Swede fell off the bridge.
Okay.
And into the water. And you're like, oh, shit. Like, I think that was the only thing, but I wouldn't really call that an ending because I guess you could have assumed the guy was dead as well, and that it almost had a conclusion feel to it with the death of the first blonde lady. I forgot her name now from the second season.
The Fair Maiden of the West, they called her.
Right, yeah. I'm not quite sure, man. I mean, I think this might be the first, if we get a cliffhanger, yeah, I think it might be. I mean, hold on. Last season was kind of a cliffhanger with Elam.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Him attacking that bear. So I would probably say that's the biggest cliffhanger we had.
All right.
So it'll definitely be interesting to see. I mean, again, it's very hard to speculate these episodes because John really doesn't give us any real clues into what he has next. He definitely goes against, I don't want to say stereotypes. he definitely every time you think you figure it out, he goes another direction. He's like bobbing and weaving, you know, making sure no one figures out his storyline. So, all right. So let's see what Reddit says on the episode 13 steps. Let's see. Okay. Top Notch Hand says, this show keeps tearing my soul to pieces. Yeah. Drive By Stoning says, that was worse than the leg amputation for me. I don't know, man. That leg amputation looks so goddamn real.
Well, that's pretty hardcore.
Yeah. The Truth Gamer says, definitely. The way the execution was shot was brilliant. The way it switched to first person view. It's not a video game, dude. It's called point of view, not first person view. Getting technical here. And the hood covers the face, the heavy breathing, blurred images, the footsteps, and the ticking clock. You could feel the fear in her breath of how scared you can feel the fear in her breaths.
Oh, breaths.
Yeah, not breaths. Come on. Of how scared she was. As weird as it sounds, I felt that scene in my core. I agree. It was probably one of the most I think that scene was just as powerful. Not slightly beneath the scene where you get silence and then Bohannon cries really loud and awkwardly, which is real life. That's real pain. You know, that's one thing I loved about that scene where Elam died and where he had to bury him. So I think this scene might be on par with that. It was a very powerful. Mm-hmm. Okay, I still don't get how you can show that, but people can't say fuck or god damn it.
Show
okay.
What?
I guess the death of people. I'm assuming the leg amputation.
What, do they watch Walking Dead?
But the people they kill are zombies, mostly gruesome.
Okay.
Yeah, that's how they get away with it. I don't know. A lot of people, this is, and one guy writes, America, like that's his response. And you know what? He's right. We are, you know, at the heart of our society, we're a Puritan society, you know, where sex and cussing is bad, but violence is A-okay. You know, you go to other countries and they are ex-nay on the violence and yay for the sex and the cussing.
Well, you know, hang a woman preacher.
Our culture.
You're good to go.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Jeez.
I have no idea what's going on now. Since there won't be a sixth season, I guess they are just going to have the... Okay, this is from Drive By Stoning. I have no idea what's going on now. Since there won't be a sixth season, I guess they're just going to have the Swede and Cullen ride around the country trying to kill each other finally. Okay. Then he finds out that somehow Durant was the one who ordered the code red on his family, rides one of those handrail carts from Mississippi where he buried the Swede under a dogwood tree to the Pacific Ocean to drive the final railroad spike through Durant's head and into the rail tile to complete the railroad.
And that's a wrap. That's a wrap, people.
I, you know what? This guy must have the inside track. I think he's actually from the writing room. This might be John Ward himself. It sounds legit to me.
That's funny.
That'd be terrible. Okay. History spoiler says Blitz and Please says Durant is a historical person. And doesn't die yet. He lives at least another 10 years. He also doesn't complete the Union Pacific to the ocean, but stops somewhere in between. I think the series will stop at that point with Colin not choosing to work under someone else to complete it. Huh. Okay. Interesting. Mm. Thank you for ruining that. Okay, Dylan Mabry says, damn, I've seen a decent number of film hangings, but that was probably the worst. Never really felt so uncomfortable watching it before. That was really well done.
Oh, okay. I thought that was going to go the other way.
A lot of people liking that scene. I think he just bad wording, I guess. It sounded like he didn't like it. Drive By Stoning says, that Gallo kid is fucked up.
Yep. He's seen a lot of people swinging.
Yeah. Let's see. Shimeko says, that was an amazing episode. The anxiety and discomfort I felt building up to Ruth's execution was intense. This season is nuts. Hollow Man says, holy shit, that part where they put the bag over her head and you just heard her breathing for a while before the thing got pulled and it went black. I had a pretty visceral, uncomfortable reaction to that. It was fucking awesome. Yeah. Looks like everyone's agreeing with that. So a lot of people agreeing.
I just don't remember, you know, when I saw it and, you know, thinking about the show today, I don't remember ever seeing a shot of a hanging like that. Usually they drop, they swing, you see their feet jitter a little bit, right, or something like that. I don't think we've ever been the point of view way, yeah, of the way it was shot being inside the black mask. I don't think, or black hood. I don't think we've ever seen that.
Yeah, I agree. I don't think, I mean, I'm sure it might have been done, but, you know, I don't remember it. So, and it was done, even if it was done, I mean, it doesn't take away with how great it was, you know, executed.
It wasn't done this good.
Now, yeah, Stone9 says, I still watch, it's just, I feel like the story isn't going to end being a happy one. I think next episode he'll find that Naomi and his son are dead, which would have left a reflation ship.
What is that?
What? I have no idea what he's trying to say. Which would have left a... That would have left a relationship with Ruth and him completely okay. Now he will have neither. Everyone he loves dies. The only thing he had keeping him going was a railroad, and now he's quit. He's such a tragic character, and I don't see what's keeping him from giving up. I think that's the point. I think that's what I have to say, that that's one thing they're definitely doing 100% correct this season, is they're making sure Bohannon is the thread of the storyline more than ever. Like, he is the focus. Everything affects him emotionally. I think that's the only way a story like this works. The story's about him, and that's it. And the railroad's just the background, you know? And I think I it's not going to end good. This is going to end bad. This is called drama.
Yeah.
You know? So, yeah, and quite frankly, I don't really want to end good necessarily. I mean, you can't have a story like this. Oh, and then he runs off to the sunset and, you know, he lives the rest of his life like Little House on the Prairie. Yeah. You know, it's not going to work that
way.
They
connect the railroad and he just has a heart attack.
If you want a positive ending, then go watch Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman, you know? So dumb. Even that, I think, had some tragic moments.
I never watched it.
Yeah. All right. Well, on that note, we do need to end the show for today, Clint. Thank you so much, everybody, for listening in today. If you ever miss any part of these shows or you want to catch up on the old shows, head over to rainmanwashere.com/weirdwestradio/hellonwheels and click play and listen. And, you know, if you enjoy the show, you like our synopsis, our analysis, I should say, then you know what? Share the show. That's the best way you can help this show keep growing. Listen, share, like it, love it, you know, debate. If you don't agree with us, that's good. That's the point of the show. Debate with us on Reddit. If you want to make a post about the show or you want to debate with us on Twitter or on Facebook, by all means, that's what I want. I want to get some great discussion going on. Right?
Yeah,
Clint?
Hashtag sugar boner. I got it. I worked it in.
Yeah. Yeah, just there you go. Thank you, everybody, and we'll see you next week for the season finale of Hell on Wheels. Nice.
Do you not believe in a higher power?
Yes, sir. Wear it on my hip.